Morning, everybody. It's a great pleasure to stand this pulpit to share this word of the Most High God, who is the wonderful Creator. The theme of this Sunday is also God creates and redeems everything through Christ. I think that is a wonderful thing which has happened, and I thank the Lord. I have been a member of this church from 1966 as a child. Grew in the wisdom of the word beautifully. Went into the All India service, retired in June 2019 to the Indian service. But something happened in 1998 when somebody shared with me about the gospel, that your wisdom, this worldly wisdom, your goodness cannot make you redeem or join God or reconcile with God. That was the time I went into this world, and as the theme says, every one of us have to be reconciled with God, because all have sinned and fallen short of glory, as Romans 3:23 declares. But the good news is, God made the way for reconciliation. It is not we who can reconcile by God with our works, with our righteous deeds, with our wisdom which we gather from this world. Never ever you can do it. I was one like that. To mean it, I say that coming into the All India service is itself a great wisdom which you should have to compete and come, and I could do it. But yet, till the age of 40, I had never been able to reconcile with God with whatever now I have today as I speak this, with truth and humility before you, that each one of us has to be saved, and that is where the reconciliation occurs. The first verse which really pricked me when I heard about it was in 1 Corinthians 3:18. It says, "For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God." And it is 1 Corinthians 3:19. "For the wisdom of this world is foolishness with God, for it is written, He takes the wise in their own craftiness." That's how we are grown in this world, with our wisdom which we have gathered from the world. But the word of God says, this wisdom is foolishness before God. And the verse above that says, "Let no one deceive himself. If anyone among you seems to be wise in this world, let him become a fool so that he may be wise." I was shocked to hear that. As a person, I have already shared with you, I was a very intelligent boy. Very well schooled, double promotions, twice in the school, silver medalist in BSc, second position MSc holder, and 12th position in the All India merit. Got excellent ACR all throughout my service till 98 also, when I got saved. In no way you can say that I was not wise among worldly standards. But yet when I read this, it shocked me. It says, "Let him become a fool so that he may be wise." That was the time when I understood that our wisdom cannot take us into the excellence which God wants, the way He wants to make us walk in the life in a beautiful and a successful way. Most of the times when we see in the Christian world itself and outside the world, we are struggling. We are really come to these conclusions that we cannot make it in this world many times. And we are thinking that nothing is possible only if God intervenes in our life. And that is the times when we have received miracles in our life, when we were not able to do anything, and yet God made us sail through and come out of situations. Yes, miracles are by God only. You cannot make it happen. No man of this world can happen, make it happen. It is there. But the situation of a miracle is really very difficult when you understand that you have to be in such a situation, in a pitiful condition, and then God intervenes and helps you. But then, when I read the word, God doesn't want us to live a life of miracles. Only one miracle He wants in our life is the salvation of Jesus Christ, the gospel of Christ. The gospel is very simple. It is not the complete word, I should say. Word is 100%. But the The gospel is very much limited in 1 Corinthians 15:3, where Paul defines it. According to the scripture, Jesus died for our sins, was buried, and has risen again on the third day. That's the gospel. I thought, what is it there so great in that gospel when I was not knowing? Even at times, I used to question. Jesus died on the cross with what? How things can change me? My life. It happened 2,000 years ago. How it can affect me? But that is the time when you read the word. And that's why I say you have to get into the word. This word is the wisdom of righteous doer. That is the word of God. Wisdom of righteous doer. And that's why if you have not gone into this word in the depth and get the revelation from the Spirit of God, I think we are missing many things. So, that's where it says that when you receive Christ, there is something which is much more than the wisdom of this world. The Bible very clearly defines what is the wisdom of this world when you get into James. If you read James 3, it speaks about two types of wisdom. First of all, in James 3:14 he says, but if you have bitter jealousy and strife in your hearts, do not glory and lie against the truth. This is not the wisdom coming down from above, but is earthly, sensual, and devilish. I'm telling you, what you see in the newspaper, what you see in the politics, is not the wisdom of God. It is actually earthly, sensual, and devilish. And what is the outcome of that wisdom is, for where envy and strife are, there is confusion and every evil deed. That's what you are finding in the world. That is the wisdom of the world. And the Bible declares it. 1 John 1, 5:19. The world is under the sway of evil one. And we all are living in this world. Mind it, we have to be very cautious. And the way we can be cautious is not by our human wisdom which we have gathered from this world. It has to be from the wisdom of God, which is the word of God. This is where it is to be taken from. And that changed my life. When I got saved, I had never read the way I have now read the word of God after my salvation. Even I was not even able to open a Bible, and I used to sit with my elder son Aman, who was in Sunday school and very good in reading the Bible and opening the Bible in our cottage meetings. But when I understood what is this wisdom which we need, and then he says in James 3:17, but the wisdom that is from above, that this wisdom is not of the world, which you can gather from your textbooks and all the philosophical textbooks and all. You can gather a lot of wisdom, and I have done it many times. I have been trained in many of our compulsory trainings from all the various very good trainers and all. But that didn't lead you to the wisdom which comes from above. It is why we see that this wisdom is truly pure. That means there is an impure wisdom which is of the world. Then he says it is peaceable. Why we are having so much of confusion even within our families? Why are we striving? Why are we having fights? Because that is not the wisdom which God has given us. Whereas the wisdom which comes from above, he says, is peaceable, gentle, easy to be entreated, very easy to adjust and walk in love with God, full of mercy and good fruits. I tell you, even the best of the best fruits which you are having today from the worldly wisdom, which I told you as I was, till 1998, I was not failing in the world. I was very good in all standards of the world. But yet he says, they are not the good fruits. Because you can see much more when you receive this word and this truth and the wisdom which comes from above. And this wisdom is without partiality and without hypocrisy. And the fruit of righteousness is through this wisdom. What is this wisdom which the Bible is speaking of? This is the wisdom which created the whole world. That's what can be read in Ministries. That is through Jesus Christ, he created the whole world. And that is the masterpiece which we see today. Which is none of us, no scientist, nothing can create the big things which God has created. Even the Bible says in Romans 1 that seeing the nature, you can understand there is God. That is that wisdom which is God is speaking. And this wisdom, when it spoke, things were created. When you read Genesis as we read today, God spoke and there was life. God spoke and there was things. No, if you really receive this wisdom and we start speaking in this wisdom, you will see the same effects in your life. Because faith, the expression of faith, is thus by what we speak. God didn't say what he saw. God said what he wanted to see. That is beautiful in Genesis. The second verse itself, it says, there was darkness and the Spirit of God was hovering it. And God didn't say how dark it was. Had he said it, it would have been dark anyway. But what he said, let there be light. And there was light, and he said it is good. In your life, what we are doing is we are not speaking from the wisdom of God. We are speaking from the wisdom of the world. The wisdom of the world will always make you confess what you see. But when you have the wisdom of God, you will start confessing what you want to see. And then the life changes. And that has, I have experienced in my life, in my workplace, in my family life, and even today, every day when we are working in this union, my Veena, my wife, we have been doing this ministry beautifully. Why? Because when you have the wisdom of God, and when you start speaking, that is what faith means. But unfortunately, most of us are not even reading this word. We say that we know Christ. Who is Christ? As we read today itself in John 1. He is the Word of God. He was in the beginning. He was with God. He himself was God. And he became flesh. And this Christ, when he says in 1 John 1, 14 and 17, he was full of grace and truth. That is what he came for. Because the thing that is lost in the Garden of Eden is one man's disobedience. That is where we have lost this wisdom which was there in Adam. You know Adam? Adam created, was having the full wisdom. And God sent the animals and he named every animal. That was the wisdom of God. That is how the maturity of wisdom of God is. Where you can know all things. As in 1 John 2:20 he says, when you are saved, when you are born again, when you receive this wisdom, that is Christ in you, you know everything. Where? In your spirit. That is what the Bible says in 1 Corinthians. Let's read some beautiful verses over there. Paul mentioned about this wisdom when he says in 1 Corinthians 1:18, for the preaching of the cross is foolishness to those being lost, but to us being saved, it is the power of God. That is the gospel he is saying. The power of God is the Spirit of God, the Spirit of wisdom, truth, peace, love, joy, sound mind. That is the Spirit of God. And he says, for it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and I will set aside the understanding of the perceiving ones. And then he says, has not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? I think that's where we have to see ourselves. Where we are having our wisdom from? From the world. Yes, very good. We should have. We should study. We should learn and everything. That's very good. That's not wrong in anything to that. But yet, there is an opportunity where you can have a wisdom which is much more than better than the worldly wisdom which we have been growing in for so many years. I grew it till the 40 years by the wisdom of this world, but couldn't accept the way now today I am doing it by the wisdom of God, which we can receive very easily. Then he says in 1 Corinthians 1:21, for since in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom did not know God, that was what I got really shocked when I heard. From the wisdom of this world, you will never be able to know the wisdom of who God is. It is only through the wisdom of God where you can know really who God is, and He is your Abba Father. See, the word religion can make you know that there is a God. Even Christianity as a religion priest does say that there is a God. But the truth of the Bible is, have we been reconciled to God through the precious blood of the Lamb? That is what the redemption takes place. We had all been fallen into sin, not due to what we did. It was due to what Adam did. That is Romans 5:19, due to one man's disobedience, many were made sinners. You didn't become sinner due to what you do. You became sinner due to what Adam did. That was his first obedience. And the second part of that verse is very beautiful. Likewise, due to one man's obedience, you are made righteous. It is not your obedience that you can become righteous. That's what the religion has been preaching. That if we start doing some right things and set right ourselves, we will become righteous. No, you will yet be a sinner. That's the problem which people do not understand. And in the Bible, when you read, sinning is not a problem for God, because God could deal sin. Romans 10, he says, they did not submit to the righteousness of God because they established their own righteousness or self-righteousness. That is the problem which God is facing in reconciliation. That is the wisdom which is coming from us, that we think that we do something good and we are doing something right. We can say, I did it. 94, 98, I was the one who went into all your past committees, Siksha Samiti committees, and all thought that if I am there and doing something for the Lord, I will be reconciled. No, it cannot be. Your goodness cannot be like the goodness of God, because even if you have sinned, if you have broken one law, you have broken all the law. Because even that's the strangest thing our worldly wisdom doesn't know. That the word, the law of God is very high. It doesn't allow that you, out of the 10, if you obey 9, you have fulfilled 90% marks. It doesn't say like that. Sin, if you have broken one, you have broken all. And that's why they have to come to the grace of God. And this is what grace does, that it can redeem us and then we can receive what God wants for us. And I assure you that that's why he says, I'm reading it further. In 1 Corinthians, the wisdom of the world, wisdom did not know God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save those who believe. For the Jews ask for a sign and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, to the Jews a stumbling block and to the Greek foolishness. Jewish people thought, and they even today many Jews don't accept Messiah as the Savior. Why? Because they have depended on their own efforts of righteousness by obedience, what they have thought. And they are not yet accepting what Jesus is for them. And the Greeks, they think it foolish. Hey, how can we? Christ died on the cross and we can be saved. That's not the foolishness of the message of cross has been treated by the Greeks. The so-called worldly Greeks have been very knowledgeable persons with all worldly wisdom. And even Paul, when he ministered to them, he said, you have made an unknown God, that is in Acts, where he says, and yet you do not know him. So, then in 1 Corinthians 1:24, Paul concludes, but to them, the called out ones, both Jews and Greeks, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. That's what the wisdom of God is. Christ, the power of God, the wisdom of God. The power of salvation is due to the wisdom of God which you receive through Christ, the Spirit of Christ in you. That's what Paul says in Galatians 4. That at the right time he was born to the Virgin, and he came into this world to redeem us from the law, that we may receive this sonship, and that he has sent his Spirit of his Son into our hearts. That is what salvation is. Receiving Christ. And now, when you have Christ in you, when you have received this Christ by grace through faith, that is what Ephesians 2:8 declares, that you have been saved by grace through faith, that too not of yours, but a gift of God, and not by your works, that no man can boast before him, and that you are in Christ's creation, so that you can ordain to do the good works which he has planned for you. And that's what my life changed. In 1998, I came into this world and understood this gospel and received the power of God, the wisdom of God, that today I am standing before you preaching this word. And now we are, I have been preaching this word not merely in churches, I have been preaching it in IIMs and IITs from this word about management, about how the communication skills have been mentioned in this Bible. And I use this word in everyday life, minister in my office and in my word, because everything is in this word, and this is only the one which has not changed. I think if you read many of your books, the editions change. There was a time when the doctors prescribed that during temperature you should not put anything colder. And today they have prescribed that you should put ice first time when you see when temperature high. See, things that the world can change, the worldly wisdom can change, but this wisdom didn't change right from the day it has been written. Breath by the Holy Spirit. That is what the power of God. You have everything in this word about relationship between children and parents, between slaves and bonds, that is the apostle and all. Everything is there. And I have applied it and it works very well. It will never make you fail. That is why, because it is the same yesterday, today and forever. That is the word of God. That is Christ, which is mentioned in this word. It's not a religion or a set of some rules which Jesus came to give you. That was enough. All the religions had very good law. None of the religions say that, say lies. None of the religion law says that you should murder. None. But then that doesn't change you. Paul declared it. If anything is righteousness, that's what it says in Galatians 2:21. That if righteousness is from the law, then it says, I do not frustrate the grace of God. For if righteousness is from the law, then Christ died in vain. See, if you could do right things and become, have a right standing with God, then Christ need not have to die for you and me in this world. He is the Lamb who takes away the sin of the world. That's what he came. He didn't come to just want to redeem the Christians. He came to redeem the world unto God. That's what we need. And that's when we receive the wisdom of God. And then we will be able to preach what the will of God is. That is what a believer's purpose is, the Great Commission. That go and preach the gospel in this world and heal the sick and deliver the evil spirits. That's what he's been called for. Why? Because the agony on this world is the same thing. The people are suffering in sickness and are totally bonded in demonic forces and all, and people are suffering. That's what Jesus said in 1 John 2:6. If you say that you abide in me as he walked, you should walk. Where are we walking? Are we? It's a challenge for you, brothers and sisters. Yes, it is very good. Attend the church, everything. But get into the word. Take the wisdom of God and be a fruitful vessel for his glory. That's what my challenge is today as a church for you. And that is where you can receive it. Salvation is so simple, receiving Christ by faith. And that's what changes life. And you can change people. You have to be world changers. You have not to sit in this church merely. That's very good. And if you will be changing this world, you will be coming and worshipping and praising God on a Sunday and really praising Him that how good is His salvation and how beautiful is His wisdom in us, that we can minister everybody for every need in this world. That's what I am speaking as a champion. This is what the wisdom of God is. And that is reflected in Joseph when he says that when Joseph was bought and sold to Potiphar, that is in Genesis 39, he says he's a slave without any clothes, yet God says he's a prosperous man. That's wonderful, I have. See, today your worldly knowledge can give you many things. You can have an audience, you can have a all the MasterCards, and then yet you cannot be a prosperous man. But if you have the God of this world, you will be prosperous. And I challenge many times. You put me as a clerk in any of your MNCs, I will be a CEO in not a few days. Because the God of this world is with me. He is my wisdom. He is my truth. He is my salvation. I just stop over here. I am basically not a son, even I am a teacher. teacher of the Word of God, I would love that if you want to be taught about the Word of God, me and Meena will open our hearts, our doors are open every time. You can come and fellowship with us and learn the Word of God and see and hear the testimonies and see the way God is working. And beautifully, each and every one of you can be anointed with this wisdom and this Spirit of God, so that you can be a faithful child of God, not a servant of God. I would never say that I am a servant of God. In the New Testament, this is the benefit. The Old Testament was a servant of God. Now He wants you to become a child. And I can tell you, the child can serve much more better, because I have an experience with my father at the age of 96. He slept in the Lord in 2014. None of the servants could do him so better as I could do it. That's what He wants, that we should become the children of God and be led by the Spirit, and be led by the wisdom of this wonderful Word of God, that we may be a successful and prudent and wonderful life for the world. I thank you, and I just close this word with a small prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for this day, Lord, that giving this wonderful anointing to teach and preach this word, Lord. I pray, Father, that each and every one, the word may sink into their hearts, Lord, and be fruitful to give 34, 64, and 100 fruits, Lord. Lord, Jesus may become their wisdom, Lord. They can receive it, Lord. As you say in James 1, if anybody lacks wisdom, ask from God. He gives it unbelievably, Lord. Lord, I thank you for giving me the wisdom which comes from above, to be a wonderful child of God, for being a wonderful minister for the word. And Lord, I always pray, Lord, make us usable for your glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.